Since it is now October, the month of Halloween, I thought that I would share with my audience something scary in the geologic sense. Oops, wrong video clip, although this is scary, yikes. Ah, here's the right video clip, as one of the few things scarier than a check engine light are large cracks appearing at the bottom of a house indicating foundation damage. Despite concrete being fairly tough, there was a recent widespread instance where the appearance of a single minor component mineral in this concrete damaged thousands of homes. This slow-moving problem occurred in sections of the U.S. states of Connecticut and Massachusetts, where, due to a minor inclusion of the mineral pyrrhotite from a single quarry, more than $350 million in damage was caused, as this damaged a minimum of 1,600 homes, with some estimates suggesting that as many as 6,000 homes were damaged. So, how did this beautiful mineral generate so much damage? First, let's break down exactly what pyrrhotite is as a mineral. While pyrrhotite might initially look like the fool's gold mineral pyrite, it is a completely separate compound having a number of differences in comparison to pyrite, including having a different chemical formula with one less sulfur atom than pyrite. Also, pyrrhotite doesn't form cubes, and unlike pyrite, it is slightly magnetic, is softer, and less dense. Pyrrhotite in nature almost universally forms as a result of pyrite undergoing a chemical reaction. Specifically, if pyrite-rich sedimentary rock or black smoker vents are buried underneath a substantial amount of rock, the heat and pressure will become sufficient enough to convert the host rock into metamorphic rock. This process also changes the pyrite into pyrrhotite. Concrete as a whole is composed of Portland cement, water, and about 70% rock aggregates, which are essentially gravel-sized rock particles. The pyrrhotite can thus get into the concrete if it occurs as a trace concentration within the rock aggregate. This is exactly what occurred when the aggregate was mined at Becker's Quarry in Wilmington, Connecticut, and used in concrete for some homes built between 1983 and 2015. The damage began occurring to concrete, often only becoming visible 10 or more years after being emplaced, as the pyrrhotite began reacting with iron and water molecules naturally in the air as moisture. This over time produced sulfuric acid, which in of itself can damage concrete. Water then combined with this sulfuric acid, which then combined with a mineral portlandite, which formed during the curing of concrete. This resulted in the creation of the mineral gypsum. Since gypsum is 4% denser than portlandite, this reaction caused parts of the concrete to contract, forming cracks. The opposite then became the problem, as the gypsum once again combined with water and now tricalcium aluminate to form the mineral ettringite. Ettringite is 23.7% less dense than gypsum, meaning that now the previously contracted concrete will expand, creating abundant structural instability in the concrete. Despite all the damage the inclusion of pyrrhotite in concrete caused, to the best of my knowledge, although I could be wrong here, there is not a law in the books which sets a maximum amount of pyrrhotite a concrete can legally have. While it is still debated what minimum level of this mineral is required to cause structural problems, in Europe they ban any concrete from having more than 0.1% sulfur by weight if the mineral pyrrhotite is detected in the concrete. Assuming a minimum amount of iron exists in pyrrhotite, it would include by itself more than the allowed limit of sulfur via as little as a concentration of 2,445 parts per million. At least one source claimed as little as 2,000 parts per million of pyrrhotite in overall concrete can cause damage, so I personally suggest a maximum limit under this amount. As a final note, many aggregate quarries now test for pyrrhotite to prevent a similar problem down the line. I would like to thank this channel's patrons on Patreon and channel members on YouTube.